The Morning Show Courtroom is powered by LegalWise.
Well, LegalWise wants to give you legal power this Labour Month, which is why we've been asking you to send some of your labour-related questions on their Facebook page. And now, again, we of course collected some of your queries, which, with the help of LegalWise Head of Legal Research, George Pelser, will be discussing today. George, welcome.
Morning. Thank you.
Morning. Now, we've of course seen some of, very important questions being asked here, and I'm hoping that you can assist us. So we're going to get straight into one of our viewers who sent a message and said that when a company, rather, this is a scenario that they're painting, right? When a company, of course, wants to transfer you to a different location, but you cannot accept it due to being to it being too far, rather, can they say that they will retrench you and still retrench you without you receiving your package?
Yeah, so what we're dealing there with is basically more retrenchment-related matter as well. So, as we explained previously, well, a retrenchment is a form of a dismissal in a sense, but to no fault of the employee. It's usually due to some operational requirements, maybe economical factors that might take into place, technology taking over these days, and that might lead to the retrenchment. And probably what happened here is they followed the correct procedures and they went through the whole consultation process, because that's what an employer must do before they can retrench. They must consult properly with the affected employees, give them notice, give them an opportunity to say, let's see if we can't get some alternative than a retrenchment. And if there's another option available, they can then say, or another position available in the company, they can maybe offer that and say, listen, we have a position here. Will you be willing to relocate to that area?
Yeah.
And that's probably what happened here. When we look at the package, the severance package, it's the basic one is that the minimum is allowed 1 week's pay for every consecutive year that you're working. So that's just the minimum, and an employer and employee can agree to something else if needs be.
But
so unfortunately then for Section 41 of the Basic Conditions of Employment Act says that if an affected employee unreasonably refuses to accept an alternative offer given by the employer, then he or she will not be entitled to a severance package.
All right. Well, that's something for, I guess, our viewer to consider there. Let's get into our next, query here, which is quite interesting. It says that, our viewer says, can an employer rather deduct 2 days of sick leave for every single day that you are booked off? So what happened with this particular employee, according to them, is that they had a back injury, right? And they were booked off for 7 days. But the employer told them to take 14 days off sick leave, as they said that this was the what the law rather provides. Mm-hmm. Now, they say that as the employees, everyone is upset about this because there's a bit of confusion there from what the employer said to what's actually happening.
So what the employer is inquiring is a double sick leave, basically.
Yeah.
So what the Basic Conditions of Employment allows for in the minimum is that you're entitled to 30 days of sick leave over a period of 3 years, and it usually accumulates in the form of, for the first 6 months that you're working there, you only get 1 day of sick leave for every 26 days you're working there, and then thereafter the rest of the 30 days would kick in. So usually the process is that if you're booked out for 1 day, you're entitled to take 1 day sick leave. The employer can't now ask and say, listen, you have to take double the amount of sick leave. If that's the case, then they must give you that day's off as sick leave if they insist on you taking double the day's sick leave. But unfortunately, we're not aware of all the facts. There might be something that happens there. But the basic rule is that for 1 day booked off, that's 1 day sick leave.
That's 1 day sick leave. All right. Well, another viewer here has asked a question with regards to disciplinary hearing. And they say, can an employer have or rather hold a disciplinary hearing without pre-hearing investigations? So what happens if, there is no case or no evidence whatsoever, and automatically you are taken or summoned to a disciplinary hearing?
So that's something interesting. I see it happening quite often if I looked at the questions as well coming through from the public. There's no formal procedure basically on how to conduct a disciplinary hearing.
Right.
Through the ages and through court cases, a procedure came into place, and it usually starts with an investigation from the employer. It's the employer that must prove misconduct to say that this is what we are charging you for, this type of misconduct, whether it's stealing or assault or something in that regard, or negligence. And they will have to prove that at the disciplinary hearing. And the way they can do that is to do an investigation beforehand, before they get through that. If they don't do that, that will be to the detriment of the employer, because the employer will now sit at a disciplinary hearing, not having all the evidence in front of them, not having all the facts of the matter. So the chairperson cannot then make an informed decision at that stage.
Right.
So if that's the case then, and they go forward with no evidence or no proper investigation, the chairperson then still says that you're guilty,
right,
and it may be lead to a dismissal, then that might be an unfair dismissal because there's no substantive, there's no proper reason for that dismissal. And it can be taken to the CCMA.
All right, then. Well, let's look at our last question for you, George, from our viewer. They say, what options do I have if I'm constantly being threatened by my employer that I will lose my job? So for every, I don't know, hiccup or mistake that you have, it seems the employer will be quick to throw the you will lose your job card on you.
Again, various factors that might play attention. You mentioned that a mistake made or something. Mm-hmm. So when we look at poor work performance, because it might be that, listen to me, Lou, you're not doing your job properly, we're going to fire you.
Yeah.
There's also strict procedures. They must go through a poor work performance and a performance improvement plan, like try and guide you, try and update your skills as well so that they can say that, listen, these are the standards that we want you to meet. We went through this whole process, you still did not meet the standards, and that might then lead to a dismissal. So there's some procedures that they must follow before that. It might also just be that it's a general, I don't know what the reason might be, but again, if it's misconduct, constant late coming, again, procedure that must be followed. It must go through a proper hearing, get the proper warnings and all that in place. If it gets so bad, then the employee can lodge a grievance against the manager, for instance, to raise it with the HR department and say, listen, this is getting too much for me. It can even get to such a point where it's a form of harassment from the manager because it's so constant.
Right.
Yeah.
And I wanted to ask you because it seems most of the cases that I've read here seem to be working against the employer. So it's employees talking about, you know, what they should do in scenarios where the employers are involved. But as an employee, when is it the right time, you know, for one to lodge a complaint with the CCMA? Is there a procedure that an employee has to follow before they escalate the matter to the CCMA?
So as a general principle, it's usually encouraged to try and resolve disputes in-house. And if there's an HR department, try and go to the HR department to raise this question. That's why the grievance procedures are, and that's usually an internal process. Try and resolve the dispute as much as possible so that you try and avoid having to go to the CCMA.
Right.
But then when we deal with CCMA, it might be that there's unfair discrimination or an unfair dismissal, and that's then when you have to go to the CCMA. And strict timelines, for example, with unfair dismissal, you have to refer it to the CCMA within 30 days after the dismissal.
All right. And of course, LegalWise does assist in these regards?
Yes, we can assist with paralegal services if you're a member, giving you advice, trying to assist with maybe trying to resolve this problem for you in-house as well. And then should you be covered in terms of our terms and conditions, we might be able to assist further.
All right, George, thank you so much for
your time.
Thank you for coming on to the show. LegalWise Head of Legal Research, George Paulser, joining us right here. And we'd like to ask you to continue sending in your questions on the LegalWise Facebook page. If you haven't signed up with LegalWise yet, remember you can SMS JOIN, that's J-O-I-N, to 41295, and they'll get right back to you. Remember to join us every Thursday this month in the LegalWise courtroom as we continue to give you legal power this legal month.
The Morning Show Courtroom is powered by LegalWise.